towards the end of 2019, some good news with respect to the USMCA moving towards finally getting signed. What are the next steps?
Well, the next step, I think, is for the House to actually pass it, and then it's going to go over to the Senate. It looks like the Senate won't take it up until after the Senate takes up impeachment. Normally, the way the fast-track process works is one thinks that there's a straight up-and-down vote by both houses when it gets in front of them. The Senate is a bit of more of a wild card just because senators have a lot more leeway than individual House members do. And the last-minute concessions on pharmaceuticals might make it some room for some more drama when it gets to the Senate, but we won't know that for a couple more months.
We saw a little bit of drama with respect to Mexico weighing in on some of the language that they hadn't seen before, right?
We did. There were some ruffled feathers, sort of, over the weekend. So Mexico's top negotiator, Jesus Seade, reacted strongly to some language in the Protocol of Amendment, which is what the three countries signed in Mexico City last week, that essentially referred to the U.S. right to install what are called labor attachés in the U.S. Embassy in Mexico City. And the idea is that these would be, I guess, trade experts on the ground who would monitor and collect information on the labor reforms, Mexican labor reforms that are built into the deal. That's very important to the Democrats that those get implemented. And for Mexico, which had balked previously at the idea of having U.S. inspectors in Mexican plants, I think it probably felt a little bit too close to that idea. So that was what we saw. We were talking about this yesterday. It looks like it's a bit of a tempest in a teapot, and it's kind of been handled.
Yeah, I think so. I think there was probably a lot less there to begin with. I think there was a bit of spiking of the ball by the Democrats that made it look like Mexico had conceded a lot, and the Mexicans rushed to move the Protocol of Amendment through their ratification process, through their Congress, really quickly before seeing the implementing bill. I don't think anything that Seade said was there was actually there. I think it was just trying to make a statement, trying to make sure that it was clear that these attaches, you know, basically any government that wants to send someone to an embassy can send whoever they want. It's really just that clear. It's never was clear that it was there were going to be people doing the inspection. So we'll see more bumps like that. I think the important thing with any kind of trade negotiation and NAFTA in particular, and NAFTA 2.0, is not to sort of get totally thrown off course by any of these little bumps. I think the next big one that I see that I'll be watching will be that pharma one as it comes up in the Senate.
Is it welcome news for Canadians with respect to that phase one U.S.-China deal, or do you think it'll leave out Canadian agricultural producers?
Oh, I think agricultural producers are pretty worried, actually. So we don't really know a lot about the deal yet because they haven't actually released the text or the details, and it's just sort of both sides saying, you know, in broad strokes what's in there. But the U.S. has said that there will be a significant increase in Chinese purchases of American agricultural goods. Certainly for Canadian soybean producers, that's a concern because soybeans have been sort of on the front end of this dispute from the very beginning, right? So for them, they've already seen a dramatic plunge in Chinese purchases of their products. I think they, on an average year, probably, I was thinking about this on the way in, they probably see China purchase about 2 million tons of soybeans. This year, they'll be lucky if they hit 50,000 tons. They haven't had a single bulk export of soybeans since last December. When the Meng Wanzhou issue arose. So yeah, I think Canadian agricultural producers are very concerned, canola too.
Mark, I'm wondering whether or not our mining sector is headed down the same path as our energy sector with respect to rare earth minerals. I think that China has tried to dominate for such a long time. What does the federal government need to do?
So the real opportunity here, this is an opportunity for Canada to benefit from the U.S.-China trade dispute, if we take it. China has made itself one of the major suppliers of what are called rare earths, which are actually turns out aren't very rare. They're just very environmentally unfriendly to produce, and China has gone into that in a big way. A lot of people don't really know that, but if you look at your cell phone, the cell phone batteries really operate off of rare earths and graphite and lithium and all these things that come out of the ground. And we have a lot of them in Canada. And the United States has begun to become very, very concerned about the security of its supply chain from China. And so they're looking to Australia and looking to other countries to secure that supply chain. Canada, the Canadian government has begun to talk to the U.S. about it. And the question is going to be, can we ramp up production and processing in Canada in a way to benefit from this opportunity? I think one of the interesting things that I looked at, you know, one of the spats that arose, we talked a little bit about the Mexico spat over the labor attaches, but the other one that came up before that was aluminum in Canada. Mm-hmm. And I did notice that the Aluminum Association, in what they put out, they said that they're quite satisfied with the agreement. And they also mentioned in there they're looking forward for the opportunities of working with the U.S. government Defense Department. And why that's interesting is that aluminum is one of those critical minerals that the United States is concerned about the quality of supply. And so I think they may see themselves as secure through that avenue, if not necessarily through NAFTA 2.0.
Do you think that Trump has since kind of softened his stance on trade?
Oh, I don't know about that. I think he needed a couple of deals to get done. He's heading into an election next year. Getting the USMCA done, as much as the Democrats have tried to emphasize that they've put their stamp on it, it's a different deal than arrived in their hands in the first place, is a win for him. And, you know, it's a good thing for him to have going into next year. Same thing with the US-China deal. Once we have a better sense of what's in it, we'll be able to evaluate whether it's a good or a bad or the greatest trade deal ever, but for now, you know, it looks like a win for him.
I think Trump believes in leverage, using trade tools as leverage, and so he's never going to put it away. He still is, you know, threatening a little bit in terms of tariffs on, national security tariffs on autos, and that's a way of getting the Europeans to the table. He slapped back on tariffs on aluminum and steel with Brazil and Argentina because he wasn't very happy with some of what they've been doing in terms of cozying up to China as a source of supply for some of these agricultural products. And so we're never going to be completely out of the woods with Trump. I always try to make the point, though, that it's not just Trump. I understand that some of the policies he's pursuing on trade are broadly popular with the Democrats, as we saw with the signing of USMCA. With the China deal, the Democrats actually criticized him for not going far enough. So from a Canadian point of view, I think we have to adjust to the new normal, that the United States is sort of retrenching a little bit, and I don't know that we're going to see anyone that's going to pull back from that anytime soon.
Towards the end of 2019, we saw the Liberal government introduce the mandate letters. And I'm wondering about some big themes heading into next year. International trade, interprovincial trade. What do you see as some of the big themes next year?
I see interprovincial trade potentially becoming a very big theme. We know that there's a ton of potential there. It's worth, a fifth of our GDP, internal trade. And the Bank of Canada has said that if we could get rid of some of the barriers between provinces, we could increase output by 2/10 of percentage points. So I think that that could be a very big theme. And if you want to get a sense of its importance, you can look to who Trudeau assigned to take care of it, which is Chrystia Freeland. She'll be managing that file. She seems to have been doing a very good job with USMCA. So her taking on that issue, I think, signals how important it's going to be going forward.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I have to be honest with you. I think interprovincial trade is a little bit like trade diversification. We're right by the United States, and so we can talk a lot about trade diversification, and governments have tried to do that for 100 years, but we always end up going back to the United States because it's just we speak the language and they're close by, and it's not to say we don't want to try to exploit the opportunities under the Trans-Pacific Partnership or the CPTPP or the CETA with Europe, but it's hard. It's hard work. It means people getting on the ground, establishing contacts, and doing groundwork that, you know, it's always going to be difficult for Canadian exporters. Interprovincially, I think when you actually sort of drill down on it, a lot of the real barriers are in the service sector as opposed to in hard exports of goods. We think of alcohol, which is goods, which is difficult and politically. But getting at those services barriers will be tough for any government. So I don't think I'm going to bet too much on seeing much progress on interprovincial trade. I think we'll continue to see lots of papers, maybe some meetings, yet another pronouncement that they've solved the problem, and then we'll come back and talk next year at this time that they're still starting at it again.
So what's a big one for you in 2020?
I think it's the same ones we've been watching. I think we have to watch how the China-U.S. dispute plays on. I mean, we touched a little bit on Huawei and Meng Wanzhou, the vice chair of Huawei, who is subject to extradition in Vancouver. We're going to know more about her extradition case in early part of next year. And that promises to tell us what's going to happen. If by some chance the court in British Columbia decides to rule in her favor, Does she all of a sudden get on a plane somehow back to China quickly, and then we sort of have an issue with the United States? I don't know how that plays out or whether it's a long process of appeals. But in terms of dealing with the China-Canada trade disputes, you really have to see some resolution to that Huawei issue. And I don't think we're going to see that through the U.S. side. It'll have to be through a resolution of that extradition case in Vancouver.